We came to a spot at the foot of some wooden steps that lead up into this room. They're just 10 feet from me there by the window as I stand. There, at the bottom of those steps, they found the half-burned body of a man with a lock of black hair on the right-hand side of his face and a little black moustache. And they looked at him more closely, and their doctors came to the conclusion that it was what they call a bad double of Hitler and not Hitler himself. If that is so, then all trace of him has disappeared.
For many, many, many years, the Germans always have big influence in all aspects to the life. In the schools, the way the instruction been doing, and the industry, and the commerce, and the political. Many Argentinian high-class people, rich, very, very rich, protecting that people too, for economical reasons. The people coming with a lot of money. Hitler probably coming after 6 or 7 months when I was working. The first time I remember, Mandava told me, today is going to be a very, very, very high man. And this person appear up, you looking like you feel the power in him, black hair with little touches of white, skin, face, no mustache. He receives so much respect. Who this guy is here? Need to be a big, big guy, because you tell me, people who come in, and Martin Bormann was there. If Martin Bormann was the biggest one, I'm not being surprised. But when Martin Bormann was there, everybody had respect, everybody standing and shake the hands, and you see the respect the people have for him, you know. And Mandava say, you know who is it? He say, no. He say, the Führer. He looking very, very different to the first time. He seems more fresh. At that time, I see the person baggy eyes and looking very tired. He look like me now, difficult to walk, difficult. I feel the guy feeling depression. This is the first time ever I talking about these things. It's frightening, the people is frightened talking about this, because in Argentina the Nazis is still. The Nazis not disappear in Argentina. The Nazis in Argentina is one thing who been there, grew there, and is still there, is going to still for many years. Many people have Nazi mentality.
History tells us that the most despised man of the 20th century, Adolf Hitler, and his wife, Eva, killed themselves in the hell of the surrounded Führer bunker in Berlin in 1945. But across Argentina, in the files of the FBI, and in the words of the following eyewitnesses, a different story appears.
Thank you. It wasn't the way we had thought it would end. People had forgotten him. The world, or most of it, believed he was already dead. Time had just passed him by. The world was now a very different place. The secret had been kept for so long. Now, it would have to be kept for even longer.
At least his family came back to say their last goodbyes. I wouldn't have blamed her for staying away. We've been preparing Operation Fireland since 1943. Between them, General Müller and Reichsleiter Bormann had done their job well. The Argentine dictator Juan Domingo Perón knew, of course. Grand Admiral Dönitz had told his men, "We have built for the Führer in the deep south a Shangri-La. And across Argentina, we had." Many of our submarines had landed since that time, bringing valuables and people. The greatest treasure ever looted was now ours to use. I had come in 1943 with General Faupel and had stayed to prepare the way if the unthinkable should happen. And now it had. General Fegelein had only arrived a week earlier, but had soon taken charge. Of all the mountain people, he was the most trusted. And as Eva's brother-in-law, the closest thing to family they had in the Land of Fire. Patagonia was a virtual German colony. And, of course, they were dead. Who would be looking for them? Müller had used the trick many times, faking his, Bormann's, and the Führer's death.
In 1945, I was the housekeeper at the Estancia San Ramon. The whole house had been busy for days. Guests had already arrived from Cordoba and Buenos Aires, and we'd been told to expect more. The ranch was German-owned. I'd worked there for about 10 years after my husband passed away. We had one of the only radios in the area capable of picking up news from Europe. Bariloche, our nearest town, was about 25 kilometres away. The road was awful, but we were pretty self-sufficient on the ranch. I wasn't surprised when I heard the Hitlers were coming. Anyway, no one here believed the stories that he'd killed himself. The San Ramon Estancia belonged to the Prince of Schaumburg-Lippe, part of the family of Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, who was himself an SS officer. Bernhard was often in Bariloche after the war.
The last 12 months had taken its toll on his body, if not his spirit. Without the penicillin we got from Dulles, that bloody Stauffenberg bomb would have finished him off. No one knew just how many festering splinters had come out of the table, or how close he'd been to death. But here, enjoying his favourite foods and safe with family and friends, his health was improving. The family have all been learning Spanish.
Su español está muy bien, ¿eh? Muy bien.
Yeah. Sí, tiene un profesor.
The Führer himself working with his daughter on the strange new language. There are even signs of his sense of humor returning. But as usual, there was a time for relaxing and a time for planning. He might be in exile, but with Bormann controlling the largest fortune in existence and Müller directing operations, now was the time to plan for the Reich's continuing existence.
Is it good, Eva?
Even after just a couple of days in Argentina, they seemed happy. We'd chosen well. The whole area felt like their home in Bavaria. And now they were safe, hidden in the Patagonian mountains, and again amongst trusted friends.
They stayed with us, I think, for almost a year, and then sometime around the end of 1946, or the beginning of 1947, we were told that Hitler had a car crash close to the property and had died. We never saw the family here again.
Now they were dead twice. Even here, the trail was dying. It was time for rebirth.
They were here, Hitler and his wife, at least three times after the war. The first was in 1946, when they stayed for about 3 months. Every day they would walk along the edge of the Machiquita Lake. His bodyguard said he used to say, "The sunsets here are wonderful." The Eichhorn family had a large property just along the coast. They were big Nazis. Before the war, they'd visited Hitler in Berlin. The hospital, which they called Hotel Vienna, was built in 1943 at a cost of some $25 million. It was as much of a five-star hotel as anything. The hotel was miles from anywhere, but still had plenty of guests. Many of them came for medical treatment. Most of the staff were Germans from Buenos Aires. There were a few local people working at the hotel. Out of the 70 workers, 30 were security. Everyone knows Hitler and Eva stayed here after the war. They had their own linen, crockery and cutlery with the letters AH printed on it. When they were here in 1946, the hotel was closed to the public. It never reopened as a hotel.
The complex at Inalco, 20 properties over 8 kilometres of lakefront, was finished in 1943, the same year as many of our other properties across Argentina. Accessible only by seaplane or boat, it was guarded by the Saracen Tower, which had commanding views overlooking Lake Nahuelhapi.
I was born in Hanover in 1912 and served as an engineer on the pocket battleship Graf Spee. After we were interned, I escaped and lived under the name of Pablo Glocknik. I was there when two of our U-boats arrived off the coast back in July 1945. I'd been assigned to Inalco, but didn't know why.
Gracias.
Here, the Führer would recover with his family and plan the rise of a new Reich.
Then I saw him. Hitler didn't have the same face. He was a bit changed, but it was Hitler. For me, Hitler was God. At times I woke up and asked myself, is it really true that I'm with the Führer? An amazing thing.
For the Rolleiflex girl, Eva. I think to start with, it was just one long holiday. Away from a shattered Germany with her new husband for the first time and finally able to play happy families with their daughter, Uschi. She hadn't seemed so happy since the late 30s. No more hiding as Fräulein Braun. Finally, she was Eva Hitler.
Martin Bormann arrived at the center for the first time during the month of April 1948. He had also changed his appearance. Other guests had already arrived. Two of them senior generals, and the others Argentine supporters and financiers. Bormann's mission was serious. With over 900 front companies in neutral countries, the Braun eminence had managed to get away with the biggest crime in history. Bormann had worked tirelessly. The center in Patagonia was to be the hub of an international network. On 26th of April, Hitler and Bormann had a private meeting, which lasted almost 3 hours. The planning went on for 17 days. Nobody wanted to leave anything to chance. Bormann was to be the key man, and all the orders and plans prepared in the centre would come from him. A huge amount of money would continue compromising important figures in government, finance and journalism. Bormann wasn't going to stay with the Führer. He said his place was not at the Führer's side. Not until the party could rise again. His place was in the outside world.
When the war was over, I was around 15. My parents gave me permission to go to La Falda to stay with the Eichhorn family. The Eichhorns were like my guardians.
Sentémonos, Catalina. Mañana viene gente muy importante a comer. Yo quisiera que la mesa esté impecable. Las sillas, todos los muebles. Las flores, por favor, ocupate de las flores de la mesa.
They were alone and they didn't have any children. They were dedicated Nazis, and although the government had taken some of their property from them in the post-war Nazi purge, it didn't seem to have hurt them. She was very excited and wanted to make sure everything was right. I hadn't seen Hitler come to the house.
Buenos días, señor.
I instantly knew who it was because there had been many photos of him in the house, although later they all disappeared. He had the same features as in the photos. I think he had a wig and no moustache. But if you shaved your moustache off, don't tell me you wouldn't be recognised. To me, he was like a normal man. I didn't see anything strange. He wasn't short like they say he was. He was tall enough. He had a rosy face and his eyes were kind of blue. I guess that he was the same age as the mistress, around 60. To me, he was already an old man. While he was there, Mrs. Eichhorn would go up to Hitler's room to talk and spend almost the entire day there. She knew that I knew and smiled as if we were sharing a secret together. It wasn't nice to see him, knowing who he was, but I wasn't scared. He ate the same food as everyone else in the house, typical German meals, sausage, ham, vegetables. He only drank water. No one in the house ever drank alcohol. He left his clothes outside the room and I would take them and clean and iron them. I never washed his underwear.
Bonita, ¿cómo anda?
He wouldn't come down to eat in the main dining room and, apart from the Eichhorns and me, wouldn't show his face. I know the family had visited with him in Berlin in the 30s. They used to show film of their tea with him to special guests. I asked the chauffeur, Efren, and he told me that it was Hitler, but he also told me, shut your mouth, don't say anything.
No quiero que hables ni una palabra de esto, ¿eh? ¿Entendiste?
Sí.
¿Seguro que entendiste?
He left the main house and Efren took him to the castle at the top of the Sugarloaf Mountain close to La Falda in Cordoba. Signora Eichhorn told me, today we are going out to eat lunch. The signora wanted me to wear something smart. I didn't like it much. It was very German, not at all stylish. We made a picnic and went with the chauffeur and with Signor Eichhorn up to the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
friend the chauffeur and I had to stay outside. He said if anyone asked, you have to say we went to Cordoba. I was not to say anything, to maintain absolute silence. Efren was my friend, but he was very serious about the Germans.
In 1951, I was working at the clinic of Anestesia Ivarando, a well-known private hospital in Comodoro Rivadavia. A German rancher who had been shot was brought to the hospital for treatment. He wasn't badly hurt. That particular day, he wanted to look his best.
Vielen Dank, dass Sie gekommen sind. Herzlichen Dank. Es geht gut, es geht gut. Es muss gehen, ne? Geht's für Ihnen? Ja, es tut noch ein bisschen weh, aber...
I remember I had to stop myself shouting out. And I rubbed my eyes in amazement when I saw who it was.
Es ist ein bisschen warm hier, aber... Die Krankenschwester ist ja nett.
I was so scared. I could feel myself shaking. I'd met Hitler the first time while working as a nurse in France in 1940, and although I didn't have the opportunity to speak with him, I saw him closely several times. Hitler had aged a little, and his moustache was gone. His hair was greying. But I had no doubt it was him, because of his presence, the look in his eyes, the way he carried himself. Believe me, once seen, the face of Hitler is never forgotten.
Sí, es él. Y ahora yo sé que vos también lo sabés. Así que ni una palabra a nadie. No creas que todavía lo están buscando. ¿O sí? A nadie.
I was working in a cafe when I first met the man I knew as Ricardo.
Ah, muchas gracias, ¿eh?
Por favor.
Es un bar típicamente argentino.
Muy lindo, aparte. Sí, sí.
He had hired my brother and also needed someone to write letters and documents.
Mi hermana.
¿Tu hermana?
Araceli, por favor, te presento al señor Ricardo. Araceli, mi hermana.
Ricardo.
¿Estás bien?
Bueno. He was very charming.
Bien.
And I wanted to change.
¿Cierto?
Sí, por supuesto, somos muy parecidos.
From that moment on, we became good friends. Ricardo said he was a senior Nazi and that he'd arrived to Argentina in 1948 with the help of the Catholic Church. He said he had been in hospital and had had some work done on his hair and his nose. He wouldn't have been able to tell.
Yeah, siempre, yeah. No, no. Yo he aclarado esto muy, muy bien. He sido completamente claro al respecto. ¿Ah?
I ended up working for him.
¿Cuántas veces tengo que repetir que todo tengo que supervisarlo yo mismo en esta oficina? Ya, todo, sin excepción.
His business was run out of a factory in Buenos Aires.
¿Sí?
It made fridges, not electric ones. They had petrol motors and were used in farms in the country. He was a tough businessman. Ricardo had 4 or 5 passports. Sometimes he would use the name Daniel Dupré from Belgium.
Jorge, archivamos, ¿eh?
He was a very wealthy man.
¿Cómo va?
Once I saw a transfer for $400,000 from Europe. He said he had shares in a factory in Belgium, another in Holland, and a match factory in France. He seemed to be well-educated, dressed smartly, and spoke many languages. He liked music a lot. He liked reading, too. He said he'd had a big house in Germany where he had a special room just to listen to music. He was always saying how much he would like to show it to me. He'd send me flowers, expensive presents, and take me out for dinner and dancing to the most expensive places. He loved good food. He wanted us to be lovers, but I just wanted us to be friends.
Cabeza de un noble potrillo que justo en la raya afloja al llegar y que al regresar parece decir: no olvides, hermano, vos sabés, no hay que jugar. Por una cabeza metejón de un día de aquella coqueta y risueña mujer que al jurar sonriendo el amor que está mintiendo quema en una hoguera todo mi querer. Por una cabeza todas las locuras, su boca que besa borra la tristeza, calma la amargura. Por una cabeza, si ella me olvida, ¿qué importa perderme mil veces la vida? ¿Para qué vivir? Thank you.
I met Hitler a number of times when he came to Pavelich's building sites in Mar del Plata in the 1950s. I recognised him immediately. Pavelich's wife, Maria Rosa, adored Hitler. He looked basically the same as the pictures I'd seen from the wall. He was older, but no moustache. He was very pale. I'd heard about Hitler from Rohr, but never about Pavelich. It was only later that I knew he'd murdered almost a million people. Signora Hitler was just over 40 years old. She wore cheap clothes. She gave you the feeling that she had suffered a great deal. She always seemed worried and almost never smiled. I saw Hitler at least five, maybe six times.
Suficiente. Pablo.
Amazingly, I remember he had kind eyes. He didn't have a hard look.
Hasta luego.
Pavelich, however, had hard, penetrating, dark eyes. He was a very rude man. The intelligence services had to know that Hitler was in Argentina. They must have protected him. I think the great powers in the world were keeping him on ice in case of a possible war between the United States and Russia. After all, even though he was an evil monster, Hitler had been followed by the whole of Germany. They disappeared from Mar del Plata, both Hitler and Pavelich, in August or September 1954. I never saw him again.
Apart from his many other business interests, Ricardo also sold diamonds in Buenos Aires. He told me that he got $120,000 just for one of them. Ricardo had brought many precious stones with him from Europe. He also told me he had a big house and helicopters. He was always trying to impress me and get me into bed. He said he had slept with many women. He stayed in the Plaza Hotel. I didn't go in there.
Vuelve a dormir, Alicia. Voy a estar ocupado.
Hijo, venga a mi despacho, por favor.
We were at the house that Perón had on Teodoro García Street. Ludwig Freuder had given it to Perón as a present when he married Evita.
Borman dijo que a las 12 va a estar por acá. Así que a las 12 en punto va a estar acá.
Sí, señor.
He was with his girlfriend, one of many. I remember once someone saying to him, Mr. President, she's only 13. He replied, so what, I'm not superstitious. He had an answer for everything. This was not their first meeting.
Puntualidad alemana, ¿eh?
Como siempre hacemos, ¿eh? ¿Cómo está?
Muy bien. ¿Y usted cómo fue el viaje?
Oh, el viaje ha sido muy, muy bueno. Estamos muy contentos de estar aquí en Argentina. He escuchado que algunos de sus generales están por sublevar.
No pasa nada. Hablan mucho, pero nunca hacen nada. Siempre es lo mismo. Gracias.
The general used the house for quiet meetings.
Bueno, ¿eh?
It was just before the coup in 1955. The president was worried, but tried not to let it show.
Es muy importante que proteja al Führer, y lo valoramos mucho.
Quédese tranquilo. Mientras yo esté acá en el poder, está todo bien.
The general was going to invite Bormann for dinner, but Bormann said he could not stay. He had other commitments. As it happened, that day I was the only guard in the house.
Tengo algo importante para usted, presidente.
Gracias. Gracias, Bormann.
Adiós, presidente.
Señor, ¿necesita algo más?
No, gracias. Bormann me hizo un regalo inmerecido.
Bormann didn't have anything in his hands when he arrived. Maybe it was something small. I never saw Bormann again, but I know he was staying at the Plaza Hotel. The police files said he had a German girlfriend there, Alicia Magnus.
Argentinos. Hermanada estrechamente con fuerzas del ejército y la aeronáutica, la marina de guerra en pleno se ha alzado en armas, desconociendo los hombres que dicen gobernar el país. El alzamiento se ha producido en el interior. Participan del mismo guarniciones del ejército de las provincias de...
On 16th of September 1955, General Perón was deposed by a military coup. With Perón gone, the new government had started serious investigations in Buenos Aires. Many people were arrested, property was being taken, and it seemed only a matter of time before the center would be discovered. For the first time, it felt as if we were being hunted. In the first days of October, two of the original senior men arrived at the center. Hitler still believed we could get through it. He had total faith in Bormann, and although it was taking longer than he had hoped to revive the party's fortunes, he was calm. After all, what was 10 years in the life of the Thousand-Year Reich? But the news from Bormann was not what the Führer expected. Bormann said for the moment it was over. Everything had to be frozen, and we had to get out of Inalco, quickly.
Listen to the bugle, hear its silvery call, carried by the night air, telling one and all. Now is the time to meet your foe, to meet your foe. To meet yourself as once I met Marlene, my sweet Lily Marlene. Underneath the lantern by the barrack gate, there I met Marlene every night a day. That was a time in early spring when birds all sing, then love was king of my heart and Marlene,
oh,
of my heart and Marlene.
Oh, my heart and Marlene.
Waiting for the drumbeat, signaling retreat.
It couldn't last. The girl who had travelled all over Europe, loved to party and be with her friends,
had had enough of their lost life in the Andes. So she left. The organization would look after her and the children.
Then I heard the bugle calling me away. By the gate I kissed her tears away. And by the flickering lantern...
It took almost a week to destroy all the evidence.
It was our last night, my last night with Molly.
His orders were clear. We were not to leave any trace whatsoever of the centre's existence. Bormann's men had already taken anything of any value.
Carried by the night air, telling one and all, now is the time to meet your girl, to meet your girl, to meet yourself, as once I met Molly, my sweet Lily Marlene. I met Molly, my sweet Molly.
In October, those of us that were left moved to a chalet 45 kilometers from the city. It was the end of the dream. I think Bormann had been planning it for years. He had broken all links between the Führer and the world. Now only he knew of Hitler's whereabouts. Things were not going as Hitler had dreamed they would. Bormann knew any chance for open political activity by the Nazis was finished. Never again would the swastika be something to march proudly before. The camps, the Holocaust, all the filthy secrets of the regime were now despised throughout the world. Bormann had other plans for the money they had taken. People like the Führer would never understand his type of ambition. They still dreamed of the glorious power of 1,000 Nazi years. But Bormann knew he could still wield the sort of power he dreamt of. His Fourth Reich would be based on money, stocks and shares, political influence, not ideals. Hitler was effectively buried alive. Bormann was now in sole charge. He no longer needed the Führer. Now no one knew where he was. They couldn't go to him and ask him his opinion and his orders. The Führer's time was finally over. His health now began to decline. He was not a terminally ill man, but he was sick. He had begun to worry about his health, and he believed there was real danger to the organization. During the first months, he suffered from depression. It was to be expected, given that the Führer had left in Alco as a man who still ran the Nazi world. When he arrived at La Clara, it was all over. On his birthday, the 20th of April 1956, I think he first realized the enormity of Bormann's betrayal. The great betrayer
was now himself betrayed. At the start of November, Bormann arrived at La Clara from Chile. He was received coolly by Hitler. But after the meeting they had, Hitler was again optimistic. Bormann stayed for 2 days, and on the morning of his departure had a meeting with Pablo. He thanked him for the invaluable services he was giving to the cause and begged him not to worry Hitler with questions of any sort and to try and make him live a quiet life. He told Pablo the day would arrive when Hitler would speak to the world, but now the most important thing was his health. We knew that he was lying. The political life of the great Führer of the Kingdom of 1,000 years had finished.
Sí. Un momento, por favor.
Hitler would call occasionally, up until the early 1960s. I recognised his voice and would ask who was calling, but he only ever said, "Let me speak to Frau Eichhorn."
Señora, es su primo.
Ah, mein Führer. Sí.
She called him her cousin.
Sí. Una alegría.
She had always said, even after Hitler's supposed death, "My cousin is travelling." They are the ones that paid everything for him. They supported him financially.
Sí.
He had a lot of contact with these people.
Adelante. Catalina, toma asiento, por favor. Catalina. Muy querida Catalina. Hace muchos años que estás con nosotros. Nosotros aprendimos a quererte mucho y te hemos confiado.
Señora Eichhorn made me promise to keep quiet. She said you have seen absolutely nothing of what has happened. She didn't have to say anything else. The Germans didn't play games. This was serious. It was best to keep my mouth shut and forget about it.
Sí, Efraín me comentó algo.
Anyway, I loved them. They were good to me. It was only after they died that I felt able to tell what had happened. By that stage, Efren had gone to live in Germany.
Here in the Ranges, I have seen his spirit bloom again.
but his nervous system has been damaged for good. Morel can be blamed for that with his quack medicine and dangerous regime of injections. Melancholy has become his most common state. Bit by bit, we have been removing ourselves from external events. Just two men live with him constantly now. His assistant, Pablo Glocknik, and I. Oh, God, help me. At times, I have felt a strange pleasure in the face of the terrible sufferings of this man. It has seemed to me that all the incalculable blood spilt clamors for vengeance on Hitler's person from the very arteries of the earth. We're a strange group, banished. Hitler, a monstrous dictator who has now lost his mask and his uniform. Pablo, a man who appears to have died years ago. And finally me, an old forgotten doctor who has found himself in the final stage of his life in circumstances that inevitably are just too much for him. Hitler has tried to return to his old passion, painting. But his hands are simply not up to it. It doesn't seem to be Parkinson's. Probably a hangover from the scarlet fever he had at the end of the First War. Whatever causes it, it makes him more depressed. He's in a state of near collapse. He spends hours just watching the horizon of the lake and the mountain like a person possessed. His physical state at times takes on alarming characteristics. He complains of sharp, neuralgic pains in his face caused by a badly executed operation. The migraines are getting stronger and more prolonged. I don't know if the seizures are caused by his mental or physical state. Both are taking him nearer to his final end.
Thank you.
The Führer's state is reaching an eminently critical point. There is no more to be done but wait until the ghosts of Auschwitz, Buchenwald, Treblinka, and so many others end up pulling him from his life. He has been suffering hallucinations for several nights. He tells me he sees mutilated faces, fields blanketed with bodies, friend and enemies alike that rise up to accuse him with trembling gestures. He can hardly sleep. The visions assault him unendingly. He refuses to eat and spends his hours between sobs, remembering his childhood.
Pablo!
Today, he appeared to suffer a heart attack. I can do little for him now. I have few resources here for him. There is nothing more to be done. His life is extinguishing naturally and quickly. The morphine keeps him calm and quiet. February the 13th, 1962, at 3 p.m., I verified the absence of life in the body of the Führer. He has gone to join the millions of beings which he sentenced to death. I cannot see it being long before I too join him in hell.
My honor is loyalty. It is now 23 years since I first said these words. I swear to you, Adolf Hitler, as leader and chancellor of the nation, loyalty and bravery. I vow to you and to the representatives appointed by you obedience unto death. So help me God. I'd always thought it would be my own death that released me from my oath. One last duty. It was the least I could do. So, they at least are still safe. Forever imprisoned by their identity, of course. But still safe. Under Bormann, things will be different. Already a new Germany is being born. Strong again.
He knew Perón and Evita, and always said Evita was more intelligent than Juan Domingo. I stopped seeing him regularly just before the factory closed down. I got another job. But I still saw him sometimes in our old places up until
1957.
Mutual friends say he continued to live in Buenos Aires until 1960, when that other Nazi, Eichmann, was caught.
Mejor programa.
Sí. Pero las tortas de los mismos son ricas.
Y podemos ir a buscar una torta.
I tried to contact Ricardo, but he was no longer there. I was skimming through a Spanish magazine and there he was. But the article was about Martin Bormann. Straight away I realised it was Ricardo. When I compared the photo with one I had taken at a restaurant in Buenos Aires, I realised Ricardo had done something to his hair. He looked a bit different from the Bormann photo, but there was no mistaking his eyes.
Ricardo.
I knew they were looking for him. I did not want to go to the police because he was a good friend, and I was afraid he could be killed. Once I knew who he really was, I was scared too. Anyway, most of the world said Martin Bormann was dead.
Adelante, por favor.
Gracias.
Por aquí.
Gracias.
estás?
¿Cómo va? Hola.
¿Molesta la luz?
No, no, está bien.
Habíamos quedado con unos datos pendientes de fechas y de documentación que me ibas a traer. ¿La tenés?
Sí.
Around the year 1985, this lady came to the office. She was a bit younger than me, blonde, tall, well dressed.
¿Querés un vaso de agua?
Bueno. ¿Fumás? ¿Fumás?
No, gracias.
She came to the office 3 times. I remember her very well. She was coming for help.
Gracias.
¿Qué pasó, Ushi?
She said she had problems with false identity documents and was married to a German, an ex-Nazi who was also in the country on false papers. He was beating her up.
Igual yo no vine por esto. Vine por el tema de los papeles.
¿Qué pasa?
Mi verdadero apellido no es el que figura en el documento. Fui criada cerca de Neuquén, en la cordillera. Mis padres se llevaban mal y mi madre lo dejó.
¿Tu mamá? ¿Está viva?
Sí. Esto fue cuando yo tenía 13 años.
Now she lived in Bariloche. Her mother had lived in Bariloche until the early 1980s, when she'd moved to Buenos Aires.
En grave peligro, ahora.
¿Tu marido sabe que venías acá?
I'm sure this woman was sane. She didn't appear to be mentally ill. She was quite normal in the way she behaved.
Es decir, le dije que venía a hacerme unos estudios a Buenos Aires. Nada más.
¿Y cómo te puedo ayudar?
I found her to be very normal, lucid and sensible. She had no reason to make anything up.
¿Alguien más sabe esto?
No. No. Mi verdadero nombre es Ushi Hitler.
I had written the book Hitler Died in Argentina in 1987. It had come about after a chance meeting with Pablo Glocknik. We became firm friends, and I waited for 10 years after Pablo's death, as I promised him, before I made it public. I got back into contact with an old family friend, Lina Rufinengo. We lived next door to her and her husband, Osvaldo, in Bolson, near the Andes in the 80s. Osvaldo's dead now, but he had been a very close associate of Perón's, and once showed me a letter from Bormann thanking him for his help. Basically, he organized Argentine passports for the Nazis.
Después de la Segunda Guerra, incluso piensa que Hitler puede estar entre ellos. Y como Osvaldo me dijo que él había ayudado a muchos de estos nazis cumpliendo órdenes de Perón, yo me pregunto si no habrá entre los archivos viejos de Osvaldo alguna documentación que a esta gente le pueda interesar.
Si los encuentro, te lo muestro. Pasaron tanto tiempo, 60 años. Oíme, ¿a quién le hacemos mal? Con eso a nadie. Ni bien los encuentre, yo me comunico con vos. Te llamo por teléfono, porque seguramente va a ser muy interesante lo que
me
cuentes.
Me parece fantástico.
Entonces,
Gracias.
Nos hablamos entonces.
Te agradezco la invitación.
No, por favor.
Te vamos a invitar a nuestra casa.
Gracias, me encantó. Suerte. Bueno, chao,
otro besito.
Dale, qué suerte. Chao, Manuel. Nos hablamos.
Sí, por supuesto.
I thought nothing more about it until later that evening when the phone rang.
Hola.
Monasterio tiene que olvidarse de esta historia de Hitler en la Argentina. Si no lo hace, tendremos que quemar su casa y matar a su familia.
Pero ¿quién es que habla? Sí, nada, no pasa nada.
Manuel.
Cálmate, quédate tranquila, no pasa nada.
¿Quién llamó? ¿Quién llamó?
Número equivocado.
Ah, bueno.
I don't mind admitting it frightened me. Not really for me, but for my wife and my family. I tried to contact Lena to find out if she knew anything about it, but she'd gone overseas to Germany the next day.
Of course I knew the Hitlers. Many of us did. They visited Cordoba a lot after the war. I knew him as Adolf. I remember he often seemed distant and lost in thought. I asked around various friends if they still had pictures of him from after the war, in the 50s. I also remember him signing books. Then the phone call came.
Hola.
Señora Müller.
Sí.
Basta de hacer preguntas sobre la presencia del Führer. La Gestapo está aún activa y es peligroso para usted y para ella.
The problem is, they say she, Eva, is still alive. Oh, but that would be ridiculous. Today she would be 96.
¿Pero ya están todos avisados? Perfecto.
¿Estás segura que estoy a salvo?
Sí, abuelita. Quédate tranquila que todavía estás a salvo.
History tells us that an insane Adolf Hitler committed suicide in a bunker in Berlin in 1945 with his wife, Eva. Rumors abounded about a daughter, Uschi. Eva Braun's brother-in-law, SS General Hermann Fegelein, was reported executed after being court-martialed in Berlin at the fall. History also tells us that Martin Bormann,
known as the Brown Eminence, and the man who Hitler said he needed to win the war, died in Berlin trying to escape in 1945, and that his body was found in 1972 and confirmed by German government DNA analysis in 1998. History does not tell us that Adolf Hitler lived in Argentina with his wife Eva and their children. But these people, all of whose testimony is real, swear that it's true. Carmen Torrentugui looked after him, his family and friends at the Estancia San Ramon in 1945. Olga Müller and numerous other people saw him and Eva at the Hotel Vienna in Mar Chiquita and elsewhere in Cordoba province in 1946. In 2008, she was told the Gestapo are still active and had her life threatened for talking to us. Catalina Gomero spent weeks in 1948 waiting on him in two properties owned by the Eichhorn family in Cordoba, at La Falda and Pan Azucar. She would take phone calls from him until 1962. Mafalda Batinic saw him for the second time in her life in 1951 at a clinic in Comodoro Rivadavia. The first time had been in France in 1940. Hernan Antsin met him in Mar del Plata five times in 1953 when he worked for the Croatian Ustashi monster Ante Pavelic. Pablo Glocknik, a former Graf Spee sailor, was part of his security detail from 1946 to 1962. Dr. Otto Lehmann was his personal physician during the same period. Many people saw submarines offloading on the coast of Patagonia in 1945. Their testimonies are well documented in Argentina. They include two Graf Spee officers. The FBI had eyewitnesses to Hitler's arrival, but never followed them up. The man who allegedly led Hermann Fegelein's court-martial, SS General Wilhelm Munk, says the last time he saw him, he was alive and well. Fegelein's father said he would often call after the war to say he and the Führer were in Argentina and fine. Alicia Oliveira, a senior Buenos Aires lawyer, tells us she has met Hitler's daughter. In 2008, Captain Manuel Monasterio, who recorded Pablo and Dr. Lehmann's testimonies, received death threats as a result of our research. Martin Bormann arrived in Argentina in 1948. Pablo saw him at Inalco. Jorge Colotto met him in 1955 when Juan Domingo Perón greeted his long-term friend and paid his hotel bill in Buenos Aires. Araceli Mendez worked for him in Buenos Aires and spent almost 3 years rebuffing his advances. She kept pictures of him. The Argentine Federal Police kept a file on Bormann, much of which was burnt in the 1960s, but documents remain, which we have, and prove he and his lover Alicia Magnus stayed at the Plaza Hotel. At least 30,000 Nazis, Ustashi, Croatia's bloodthirsty animals led by Ante Pavelic, and other European fascists fled to South America after the war. They were helped by the Perons, the Catholic Church, the Red Cross, and KLM under Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. Adolf Hitler, the worst and most evil criminal of the 20th century, often used the alias Mr. Wolf. The name Adolf comes from the High German for noble wolf. His first mistress called him Wolf, and it was as Herr Wolf that he was introduced to Eva Braun. Hitler's yacht was called the Sea Wolf, and his personal plane, the Flying Wolf. His field headquarters in East Prussia, the Ukraine and France all had the word Wolf in the title. Among the most potent of Hitler's weapons during World War II were the Wolf packs of U-boat submarines that preyed on Allied shipping. U-boats themselves were known as Grey Wolves. Their final mission of the war was called Sea Wolf. It was as part of that operation that Hitler escaped to Argentina. And it was there,
17 years after his alleged suicide in Berlin. At 3 p.m. on the 13th of February 1962, tormented, demented, and betrayed, the most evil man of the 20th century finally died. We were lied to.